Welcome to AFIC and our topic for this semester. And basically, what our interest is to look at infertility. And we find that in general, infertility is defined as not being able to get pregnant or conceive after 1 year or more of unprotected sex. It's defined as not being able get pregnant or conceive after 1 year or more of unprotected sex. So you find that women who are not able to carry a pregnancy to viability, that is about 28 weeks of gestation, and has experienced two or more miscarriages before this gestation, should also seek assistance for infertility. So as we talk about infertility as an introduction, just meaning the term infertility, and you're saying basically it is that inability of a woman to conceive after a period of about 1 year or more of unprotected sex, because there is no barriers that have been used, there are no contraceptives of any other kind that have been used, whether artificial, there's no natural method of family planning that has been engaged, but then this woman still doesn't conceive. So we are saying that this woman mostly will find that she's not able to carry a viable pregnancy. That is up to about 28 weeks gestation period, and is likely also maybe to have experienced two or more miscarriages for this gestation. And for such, we are saying that they need to seek medical assistance. They need help from gynecology. They need help from specialists who can and do all tests, return negative, and that they should be able to conceive. I know someone whom I think she had used the Depo-Provera, the injection. Remember, we say that it is used mostly for 3 months. So, but those that can take like a month or so. So, like even after she had used Depo-Provera some years back, now when she got married, they really struggled in getting children. And I think there was an aspect of infertility. She had to see a gynae on several appointments, take medications, take some ovulation drugs, take some pregnacares, take some, you know, supplements that will boost the reproductive system, and eventually she conceived. And right now she's with her second pregnancy. What am I trying to say? That it's like infertility has no solution. And it's always, it's sometimes it's an issue with couples, because some of them may have just two small fights and keep blaming one another instead of looking for solutions, because solutions will always be found. But again, should it be that case in which you find that maybe they've sought that solution and eventually nothing happens, then they need to live with that fact that we're not able to have children. So the objective, therefore, of these topic are that by the end of it, you should be able to define the term infertility, also outline causes of infertility, explain the causes of infertility in women and the tests carried out on them, and also be able to explore on the treatment of infertility or describe the treatment of infertility. So from our portal, in our notes, we do have on the portal in this topic, we do have some reading materials that you need to access, have some URL links, and it's only good if you get through them and you're able to see what I put there for you. So infertility, basically, we say that we do have primary infertility, where it's a situation where one has never been able to conceive, while we do also have secondary infertility, which is where one has failed to conceive again. So with primary infertility, it's like forever. These people are not the only conception. The sex is unprotected, but eventually for a long period of 1 year or more, she's not able to conceive. To the contrary, you find that she conceived and then after that, she's able to conceive. So what's the primary infertility? An issue of men or an issue of women. Sometimes happens to most families. You can learn their ways, not taking care of themselves, or rather not being able to conceive. So we make a struggle with infertility and sick, however, it turns But as the argument commissioners have already said, childbirth in population is the factors formation. So in the at which people wish to bear children, the same can be not a different language. So again, a difficult time to emphasizing on that when a couple of ways that they cannot bear children, it's really time of anger and hardship, the time of emotional torture, stress, that also leads to depression by virtue of not having a child. We see children come from family stories who have that hope that maybe one thinks you are and he doesn't believe that that is how you are. We begin with fertility in men. We look at some of the fertility in men. Remember, it's really part of we have that fertility can be caused by different factors and typically evaluated by a certain analysis. So, species will evaluate the number of sperm, that is concentration, motility, that is its movement, those morphology, that is the shape. So, a slightly abnormal analysis does not mean that a man is necessarily infertile. So, instead, a semen analysis helps me if and how male factors are contributed to infertility. What conditions contribute to abnormal analysis? One is varicocels. That is a condition in which the veins on a man's testicles are large and cause overheat. So the heat may affect the number of shape of the testicles. If you do have medical condition or exposure such as diabetes, cystic fibrosis, trauma, infection, testicular failure, or treatments with chemotherapy or radiation, it can also weaken the man and also functioning, having viable sperms. Then unhealthy habits such as heavy alcohol, testosterone supplementation, smoking, anabolic steroid use, and also illicit drug use. Then we also have environmental toxins, including exposure to pesticides and lead. All right, so that is about men, an explanation, overview of infertility in men. Yeah, and what will still contribute to normal semen. Then let us focus on women now. Women need functioning ovaries, fallopian tubes, and uterus to get pregnant. The conditions affecting any of these organs, the three of them, the ovaries, fallopian tubes, and the uterus. Ovaries, fallopian tubes, and the uterus. So any condition affecting any of these organs can contribute to female infertility. And some of these conditions are listed below and can be evaluated using a number of different tests. So if you do have absence of ovulation, whereby you find that it can be caused by polycystic ovary syndrome. That is a hormone imbalance problem that can interfere with normal ovulation. So it's the most common cause of female infertility. But again, with this one, sometimes you want to find gynecologists who are specialists in the female reproductive system. They're able to help and work through this. Then excessive physical or emotional stress that results in amenorrhea, that is absence of periods, of diminished ovarian reserves. This occurs when the ability of ovary to produce eggs is reduced because of congenital, medical, surgical, or unexplained causes. Ovarian reserves naturally decline with age. Then you do have also premature or early menopause. It's also a factor in itself. It can, because there are people who get early menopause as early as years. There's a lady that I interacted with some time back who were in a certain workshop. So by then I was nursing a young child. So I thought, hey, I have to leave. Because I really have to get home, I feel that my baby needs to breastfeed. So as I look out, she was like, could I drop you at a certain place because I'm heading out to that place? That's cool enough. It's all, yeah, cool. It will be of great help. I'll be able to connect fast so that I get to town, grab another mask to get home. So as we start going, she's like, hey, I really wish I had a small baby. Then I'm like, you do have children, she's like, I have, but I wish that I have a small one. So I wondered why. So I told her, maybe one day you get accepted. No, my case is different. The moment I hit 31 years, I got to menopause. So right now menopause is coming early. There's early debate on menopause, especially on women. I'm not sure if it's because of our diets or changing lifestyles. I can't really, because even studies cannot really correlate like exactly what's happening, but that could be a cause of infertility. Then we do have menopause and age appropriate decline in ovarian function usually around age 50. So it's often associated with hot flashes and irregular periods. We do have several tests that exist to evaluate a woman's ovarian function. And there's no single test which is a perfect predictor of fertility. So the most commonly used ovarian function include follicle stimulating hormone on day 3 to 5 of the menstrual cycle, and also anti-Müllerian hormone that is and follicle count using a transvaginal ultrasound. So that is basically about women. The second thing again about women, we've talked about the ovarian functioning. We could say that all those organs have to function, the ovaries, the fallopian tube, and the uterus. So the first cause we've said it could be a cause of ovulation. The second is blocked swollen fallopian tubes. So if a woman has blocked or swollen fallopian tubes, it could be a contributor of not being able to conceive. So these factors for blocked or tubal occlusion and include a history of pelvic infection, SPAD, history of ruptured appendicitis, history of gonorrhea or chlamydia, non-endometriosis, or a history of abdominal surgery. So tubal evaluation may be performed using an X-ray, which is called a hysterosalpingogram, this HSG. Sometimes you find that in the hospital, you go to the particular lab sheet, imandikwa something. So some of these terms are long and difficult. So that is HSG, or by a promo perturbation, that is P, the operating room at the time of laparoscopy. So a surgical procedure in which a small incision is made and viewing tube called a laparoscope is inserted. So when you talk about the HSG, you'll find that it's an X-ray of the uterus and fallopian tubes. So a radiologist injects dye into the uterus through the cervix and simultaneously takes X-ray pictures to see if the dye moves freely from through the fallopian tube. These are the visible calibrometer and also patency. Then we have chloroperturbation, which is similar to the HSG, but it is done in the operating room at the time of a laparoscopy. So the blue color dye is passed through the cervix into the uterus and spillage and tubal caliber or shape is evaluated. So that is very medical when we have blocking fallopian tubes. Those are the tests that are done, the HSG and the ZP. So sometimes we've already said that there could be a cause of history of infections, especially the PID. Talked about rupture, appendicitis, we've talked about history of gonorrhea or chlamydia, those are the STIs. And also we are talking about endometriosis, history of abdominal surgery. The third cause, major cause, could be uterine contour, that is physical characteristics of the uterus. And we find a woman's symptoms, uterus may be related by transvaginal ultrasound to look for fibroids or other anatomic abnormalities. So if suspicion exists that the fibroids may be entering the endometrial cavity, also hysterogram or hysteroscopy may be performed to further evaluate the uterine environment. Again, when the uterus is formed, we began with looking at the ovaries, in the sense that we say that in case someone has absence of ovulation, then it will be a cause. We talk about the fallopian tubes in the sense that in case they are blocked or swollen, it will still be a factor in terms of leading to infertility. Now we are looking at the uterine contour, we are just looking at the physical characteristics of the uterus, and then you're saying that in case of this presence of like uterine and fibroids that are likely to interfere with pregnancy or any abnormality within it, it could bring problems in terms of holding a viable fetus. So what are the factors that increase the woman's risk of infertility? You'll find that usually fertility within women is known to decline with age. So it declines with age, and it increases a woman's chances of fertility in the following ways. One, ovaries become less able to release the load. She has a smaller number of eggs left. Eggs are not as healthy as at the time. She's more likely to have health conditions that can cause fertility problems. Also, you find that she is more likely to have miscarriage. Those who are smoking, they get exposure again. They can become infertile, excessive alcohol use. Those are extreme weight gain or loss, and also excessive physical or emotional stress that results in amenorrhea, that is absence of periods. Now on our last objective about the treatment of infertility, how do we treat infertility? We'll find that treatment plans are based on the diagnosis, duration of infertility, and the woman's age. So management of any underlying female and or male factors affecting fertility may include medical treatment, for example, pharmacotherapy, surgical intervention, or both. And there are three main types of fertility treatment. We do have the medicines to assist fertility, we do have the surgical procedures, and we also have assisted contraception, the IVF. Maybe we begin by looking at the medicines in form of treatment of infertility. You find that fertility drugs are mostly hormonal. Like we do have metformin, which is particularly beneficial for women with polycystic ovary syndrome. We also have gonadotropins that can help stimulate ovulation in men and may also improve fertility in men. So those are the medications that mostly are in use in terms of treating fertility issues. Then surgery, because you said the second option of treatment of infertility is surgical procedure. So with here, we do have fallopian tube surgery. Dr. Bachman, one of the causes of the infertility could be the blocked or swollen fallopian tubes. So if the fallopian tubes have become blocked or scarred, perhaps as a result of the infertility, that is PID, you may need surgery to repair the tubes, and surgery can be used to break up the scar tissue in your fallopian tubes. So making it easier for eggs to pass along them. So in this scar, there's a blockage within. That means it is that hinders the sperm from getting freely, traveling freely in from within the fallopian tubes to reach the ovary for fertilization. So if the fallopian tubes have become blocked or something, probably it could have been blocked. Many results that I mentioned, like the PID, talked about gonorrhea or chlamydia, talked about endometriosis, talked about abdominal surgery, you know, we talked about ruptured appendicitis history. It can be corrected. So the process you said, it's called laparoscopy. Laparoscopic surgery is often used for men who have endometriosis when part of the womb lining starts growing outside of the womb to destroy or remove cysts or fluid filled sacs, and it may also be used to remove cervical fibroids or small growths in the womb. Then we do have correction of an epididymal blockage and surgical extraction of the sperm that is now on men. The epididymis is a coil-like structure in the testicles that helps to store and transport sperm. So you find that sometimes the epididymis becomes blocked, prevent sperm from being ejaculated normally. And if this is causing infertility, then surgery to correct the blockage can be performed. So surgical extraction of the sperm may be an option for men with one, an obstruction that prevents the release of sperm, such as an area of infection. Again, in case they do have a congenital absence of the vas deferens, that is men born without the tube that drains the sperm from the testicle, then have a vasectomy or a failed vasectomy reversal that was done. And also men may have a problem In terms of that, we mean that this would include all infertility treatments, in terms of a sexual or a failed vasectomy. So all these three would contribute to maybe surgical extraction of sperms from the man so that they can be able maybe to sire a child without having sexual intercourse. The third way, we said it could be assisted conception or assisted reproductive technology, that is ART. And this includes alternative treatments in which both eggs and sperms are handled outside of the body. And we find that in general, ART procedures involve surgically removing eggs from a woman's ovaries, combining them with sperm in the laboratory, and returning them to the woman's body or donating them to another woman. So the main type of ART is vitro fertilization, is IVF. That is what is most common in the world right now, and even in Kenya, it's happening, but very expensive. So success rates vary and depend on many factors, including the clinic performing the procedure. It also includes the infertility diagnosis, and the age of the woman undergoing the procedure. So ART can be expensive and time-consuming, but it has allowed many couples to have children that otherwise would not have been conceived. So the most common complication of ART is a multiple fetus pregnancy. And this is a problem that can be prevented or minimized by limiting the number of embryos that transferred back to the uterus. So it's quite a surgical procedure. It's done by medics, it's done by specialists who are good in this area. We do also have the intrauterine insemination, IUI, and this one involves sperm being placed into the womb through a fine plastic tube. And the sperm is selected. And the sperm are passed through a tube that enters the cervix and extends into the womb. And this procedure is performed to coincide with ovulation to increase the chance of conception. And the man may also be given a low dose of ovary stimulating hormones to increase the likelihood of conception. Some women may experience temporary cramps similar to the period cramps after or during IUI, but other than that, the procedure should be painless. Then the IVF itself, as we've already mentioned, you find that with fertilization of the egg, with this one, the fertilization of the egg occurs outside the body. So the woman takes fertility medication to encourage her ovaries to produce more eggs than normal. Then eggs are then removed from her ovaries and fertilized with the sperm in a laboratory dish. And a fertilized embryo is then put back in the woman's body. So the intrauterine insemination, here the sperm is injected into the woman's cervix. But then with this one, both are removed, the egg and the sperm are removed, they're fertilized within a laboratory dish and injected back into the woman's body. We also have surrogacy, and here women with male or healthy egg might also want to consider surrogacy, whereby surrogate is a woman who agrees to become pregnant using a man's sperm and her own eggs. So the child is genetically related to the surrogate and the male partner. Then you do have gestational carrier, where women with ovaries but no uterus may be able to use a gestational carrier. And this may also be an option for women who shouldn't become pregnant because of a serious health problem. In this case, a woman uses her own egg and it is fertilized by her partner's sperm, and the embryo is placed inside the carrier's uterus. So that is about the different ways of dealing with assisted methods in terms of conception or reproduction. Basically, we've talked about IVF, surrogacy, and we've talked about the gestation carrier. So by now, I know that you are able to define infertility. You are able to speak about different processes of infertility in men and women and how they can both be treated, you know, yeah, and how all can be handled and the risk factors involved. So I do hope you enjoy the class, and I do hope that we shall interact better. Should you have any queries, again, as always, feel free to consult, feel free to ask. so that we can learn together and move together. I do hope that we can interact more even in our next class. I do wish you well. Good day.